Then you won't eat it. Okay, okay, next one. Next one. Yeah, okay. This is the one. This is the one. Okay. Now this is titled as Confessions of a Thyroid Surgeon. And I'm all like you to look at these three pictures clearly. And can you judge from these pictures what confessions I'm going to make? And it's very obvious here, I'm going to make some confessions on recurrent nerve versus parathyroid. See this picture, these are all pictures taken from the workshops which are here or at my place. So these are genuine pictures which has taught me something. And I sort of suggest you that when you go home, take lots of pictures of your patient and keep looking at them yourself. So they teach you a lot more than you think they would teach you. Look at this picture. Look at this picture. Now here, in that area, and in that area year 2000, I was very happy to note that there is a inferior artery. That artery supply is there. And I was very pleased with myself to show this photograph in my earlier lectures as what a wonderful dissections I have done. About year 2005, I was able to demonstrate one more dissection. I said there is a recurrent which divides into two and there is an artery which runs up there. And I was very maha pleased with myself that I was doing a great dissection. Come in this year, I bumped into this picture and that is a $1 million worth picture. And that picture is, this is a parathyroid, this is a parathyroid, that's a recurrent nerve, that's an inferior artery coming that way and going up again there to supply this parathyroid. And that's the little branch which is entering the thyroid gland. Now, so far so good. But what is learning here? What is the confession here? Now I'll show again everything once more time and now you'll soon appreciate what is that I want to confess. I saw this, I did not see this. I did not see this. You're staring in my eyes now, but I didn't see it then. Because this is the same thing which I showed you yesterday. This is a branch which is going into thyroid, but this is continuing upwards. Going here. See? I didn't see it. But I wasn't aware of it. Same here. Was very happy. Did not see this. It was there for me to see. I did not see it. This is recurrent nerve disappearing there. What about this fellow? I did not see it. Because my mind did not know. And why did my mind start knowing this? Why I am saying that thyroid surgery is more preserving parathyroid than preserving recurrent laryngeal nerve. Recurrent laryngeal nerve will get saved, don't worry too much. It's a big nerve, unless you are a ham-fisted surgeon, unless you are clumsy with your artery fossae, you will not really damage it usually. And there may be bad luck one day, you can never tell. But usually not. Can I have the next one? Now this is just a gimmickary side. This is a big, big thing which was a parathyroid cyst which you removed in one of the camps. Next please. Now, surgical misadventure in thyroid surgery. Immediately, it can have structural problems of damaging recurrent or supralaryngeal nerve. They are usually extremely cosmetic, but at the same time, may I have to say that they are very rarely fatal. Even if you cut recurrent, what happens? Nothing happens. The man goes hoarse. Even if you recur, can I go back on one thing? I want to see this slide. Can I go back one thing just for Modi's sake? One more. This was titled as Confessions of a Thyroid Surgeon. And Modi, what I didn't see in the first part that I was showing this vessel, and I was very pleased with myself to demonstrate this vessel, that this was the inferior thyroid artery, nerve, going there, division and all that. But I did not see this fellow here. Same here. I was maha pleased with demonstrating that this was a nerve, that was the artery, and that the various ligament and all that. I did not see this fellow, which was there for me to see. Come here. That's inferior parathyroid, that's a superior parathyroid, that's a recurrent nerve, and that's inferior artery. Comes from below, sends a branch there and climbs up again to supply the superior parathyroid. Now, this is the sequence which is the theme talk of my presentation right now. Because I said I lost only one patient in the last so many years, a Juni bhai called her name, and she died of hypocalcemia 11 months after. Next please. Can we just jump two slides, yeah. Now back again. But the delayed complications are functional that because of damage to the parathyroids, they are usually insidious. People will not even notice. Even if I killed all the 4 parathyroids in my surgery, nobody will know it. But they may be potentially fatal, where the patient may eventually succumb. The cost of calcium tablets per day is almost 9 times more than the cost of electroxid tablet per day. Next please. Now this is just the diagnostics. There could be anything between 1 to 12 parathyroids, but normally 87% there are 2 upper and 2 lower or superior inferior. Sometimes 3 glands and 6%, 5 glands and 0.2%, and 6 glands and 0.6%. This is just a statistics for you, doesn't matter much. Next please. Anatomy. Each gland is so small, 0.5 by 0.4 by 0.2, or 5 mm by 4 mm by 2 mm. Not a big gland. Only weighs 35 mg. And the total parathyroid tissue in an adult individual is 135 mg. So it's not a big gland or a big tissue we are talking about. Next please. Now that's a picture we all know from the textbook, that Bayer's triangle, uterine nerve, branching there. But what we don't really see, that these two glands are literally a very close approximation or a relationship of the inferior thyroid artery. So if you are up till now dissecting the inferior thyroid artery with recurrent nerve in the mind, I'll tell you, you go back to your places and dissect the inferior thyroid artery, not with the recurrent in the mind, but its branches to the parathyroid of your mind. Because it cannot be that the big artery goes nearby and doesn't give blood supply to these people. Not likely in the nature. Next please. Now there is a picture. Now, if you see this picture several times over, and as I said, we see the same picture again and again, but we miss out because we don't see it the same way unless our mind knows. Look at this artery. This artery also shows that it's climbing up there. And that's the superior parathyroid, that's the inferior parathyroid. Now, is it likely that this fellow is coming up to here, this fellow is coming up to here, but they won't shake hands here? Cannot be. They must be shaking hands there. Next please. Now, this is just the development. Third arch, fourth arch, and the knowledge goes that the fourth arch is same as the main thyroid, so that stays with the gland. The third is same as the thymus, so it goes in the superior mediastinum for a variable distance, and therefore the relationship between the thyroid and the superior parathyroid is the same, where the thyroid and the inferior parathyroid is variable. Next please. Blood supply, this is the one. This one may be so, but not so much. Next. Now, causes of postoperative is physical removal and vascular damage. Now, physical removal is usually not the cause. I tell you why. Because the inferior parathyroids are way low. And usually you will not, unless you are really doing a semi-compartment clearance or going very much low in the neck, you are not likely to remove the inferior parathyroids so quickly. But you are likely to remove the upper parathyroids, because they are very close, sitting on the back surface of the gland. So if you do a subcapsular dissection at the top, that is enough to prevent a physical removal of the parathyroid gland. But the vascular damage is the real damage. Next please. Now, how do you identify the parathyroids intraoperatively? The one big method was giving intravenous injection volume, because they will stain the gland, because these are the maximally metabolic gland in endocrine glands in the body, and they take up the dye and they stain themselves. The second was knowing fully well the anatomical variation.
That's
but they are more active than the thyroid. Junction will be picked up by the all tissue, but selectively of the two they take up more, because they are metabolically much more active. You see, the half life of parathyroid is only 6 hours.
How much do we have?
Whereas that of the thyroxine is 15 days.
How much do we have?
The dose is 30 ml. 30 ml half an hour before surgery.
Any dilution? Any percentage?
I'll tell you, but it's to be diluted 30 ml into maybe artery. Don't know. I never done it. It's only theoretical.
How do you sterilize it?
Huh?
How do you sterilize
it? I never used it. It's theoretical. Never used it. Now study the specimen. I tell you, this is very important. After you have removed any, even that big thyroid you removed, we looked at the back end of the thyroid before you threw in a bin. Because if it contains a yellow tissue at the top, remove that yellow tissue and think if this is parathyroid. And if it is parathyroid, take appropriate action. Now, the most appropriate action is sinks and fluorine section. The sinking is the most simple thing to do. If you think that this tissue is parathyroid, take a petri dish, have a saline into it, drop this yellow tissue into it. If it floats, it is fat. If it sinks, it is parathyroid. And if it sinks, you have to implant it. Now frozen section helps, but how many of us have frozen section? I mean, maybe except Moni or maybe, I don't know, who else has? You got a frozen section? Most of you will not have frozen section facility backup. So you can rely very heavily upon this. And this is more useful in an oncological paper or oncological work where you are worried that the tissue which you are going to re-implant is a malignant tissue. But in that case, it's safe to remove it and throw it rather than bothering with the re-implantation. Next please. Now, pearls in technique. Medial to lateral, I talked that yesterday in my demonstration, I will do that again today when I get back to the OT. But this is the pearl, that the only way to save the parathyroid correctly is by doing a medial to lateral dissection. And respect the arteries as much as the nerves. Again, I said that to yesterday, that I use the loops more to see the arteries than to see the nerve. Because I want to protect all the small little arterioles which are climbing up along the recurrent vein, recurrent nerve. Now, recurrent laryngeal infiltrate artery, this is very common, and magnification of course helps. And Kuddu said the same point yesterday, that he will use the loops when he wants to protect the arteries. Next please. And not the nerves, and the common thing says. Same picture. You see, you have seen this picture there, I got that picture back in again here, just to show that there will be a fellow who will go like this, go like this, go like that, and so this is the infiltrate artery. And this is the... There, pictures in the books we don't take notice of because we feel I just make it another malum happening. But this is the diagram which I stolen from Madan State. This is not my diagram. But that shows adequately what I'm saying, that there are vessels which are very tiny, but they are definite, demonstrable vessels going to parathyroid. Next please. Now, this is the demonstration piece of cadaver dissection. I deliberately kept it. Because one of the surgeons, who is like my guru, was doubting my contention of this looping system, and this is the anatomy dissection showing the same thing, going up here. That's the parathyroid tissue here. In cadaver, it is very difficult to show parathyroids, because the parathyroids shrink and they become so small, and they are indistinguishable from the fat around it. Next please. More of the same, that there is a vessel, which will loop like that and go up. And that's the recurrent nerve. That's recurrent. That's a looping vessel. Next please. Now this is in real time. You see, this is the artery going like this. This is a nerve. The artery has come from behind, looping like this. But see the size of this branch vis-a-vis size of this branch. My point is, if this branch was so big here, it has to go somewhere again. It cannot terminate here with a small flinty thing. Small flinty thing is for the thyroid. The real stuff is going that way. To this end. So the inferior thyroid artery is the main supplier of both, just not one here. Next please. Same here. Little bit magnified version. Recurrent nerve, the artery. Next please. Now, in real life, the vessels are so small. Can you beat it? These are the sort of vessels we are talking about. And you require magnification to see these vessels. You cannot see them naked eye. That's a nerve. Next please. Now, recurrent nerve, I think we'll pass it because we've seen this. Next please. Now, this is the picture, again, worth a million. That's a nerve, that's an artery. And again, my point is, if this artery was so big, it will not send a small flimsy and disappear into wilderness from this point upwards. It has to go somewhere. And the best way is to have some depth and then climb up. Next please. Same here. Just to show multiple pictures. Next again. This is medial to lateral. I showed that yesterday and again I will show it to you if the dissection permits me today also. Next please. Recognition of misadvantage. During surgery, post-op. Next please. During surgery, re-implantation and the site. Next. Now, can you go back? Now, I would like to ask Moni, how would you re-implant? I mean, would you do a standard or?
Yes,
can you go back? Can you go back? Yeah. Because this is something which I want to know from everybody also.
If you are suspecting some malignant, really for malignant disease, never re-implant the neck. Always in the forearm.
Yeah.
But for non-malignant disease,
it's the master.
How we do that? We split it up into small, small pieces and make a pocket and then.
Yeah. How do you do it?
Yeah.
Same?
Yeah.
You see, I differ from you. All similar. Malignancy up here, non-malignancy up there. But I don't make a pocket. I don't make a pocket. The reason why I don't make a pocket, because if you make a pocket, the tissue and the muscle will have a blood clot around it. And that blood clot will not allow the neoangiogenesis to penetrate into your parathyroid. And your parathyroid will effectively get killed. The blood vessels will not grow into a clot. And therefore, if you make a pocket and then put your parathyroid there, very soon the pocket will be filled up with a blood clot, with fibrin and all that, and they will prevent your parathyroids getting a blood supply, and you are sure to end up with no parathyroids. Because they are extremely actively metabolic, requiring high amount of oxygen. So they will not survive. The way I do it is, I do same thing, you to study, chop, 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 but how much to chop that I am able to suck it into twice 21 gauge needle. I dilute them with the saline, I make a solution of it, and I keep on dicing it. I make one of the assistants, next 10 minutes you are doing this only. Chop, 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 like a mutton chop business. Keep on dicing it, keep on dicing it, and keep on dicing it till the point that you are able to suck it into a twice 21 gauge needle. And then suck it into a syringe, whatever liquid, 5cc, 10cc, doesn't matter. And then actually inject it. Don't make a pocket, inject it. So when I inject it, I am sure there is no blood clot. It's like giving intramuscular injection. That your tissue, which is a parathyroid tissue, is actually injected into the muscle. That's the difference. But I mean, this is the logic which I have done this technique. Next please. Side, we all agree that if you remove the parathyroid and you feel this is malignancy, please don't implant there because you maybe want to radiate it or remove it again. So for sake of identification, put it in the brachioradialis in the forearm. Now, how to recognize the Tavistock sign, the circumoral tingling, the muscular weakness and the tetany? Please, this is something which you demonstrate. The patient cannot tell you that I got a Tavistock sign positive. Tetany, patient doesn't know. You know it. But the best is circumoral tingling and muscular weakness. You see, we ignore these two findings. In our part of the world, circumoral tingling, ya chinchini aati hai, ya munge aata hai, ya chinchini aati hai. We ignore this complaint. But please don't ignore. That's the sign of hypocalcemia. And the second is muscular weakness, which may be marred in the case of general anesthesia that they will not complain. Tetany is very late. Of course, my observation, can I have the next slide? That's a specimen you always study. That's a CA thyroid with the next specimen. Next please. Now, whatever my early finding is, that maybe the textbook will say that the hypocalcemia symptoms come after 48 hours. My own contention is they come much, much earlier, because probably our patient have got a low calcium reserve. And in my opinion, sometimes I get them even on the same day as surgery. And therefore, don't go to sleep without instructing your staff that you must train all your staff to recognize the hypocalcemia. It's all very simple. Tell them how to withdraw the blood sample, because they don't know how to withdraw blood sample. If you put a tourniquet on and withdraw the calcium blood sample, it's all wrong, because the readings will be all wrong. The calcium will come out and you will get a high results, which is false. So alarm, false safety. So you must withdraw the blood without a tourniquet. You must tell them the location of everything. Sounds very simple and stupid, but has happened to me. They don't know where the calcium gluconate is kept. Wo handover mein chale gaya, bhool gaya, kitar hai, dhundo, oti kholo. So you must keep the calcium gluconate vial. You must keep 20 cc serine, everything by the bedside, and tell everybody. As a owner, say, nurse ko bula, and nurse should know this is what she has to do. Next please. And they should be told how to administer. Now there is lots of paper, and I can talk to you in between sometimes or maybe even in the night, as what should be the protocol, how long should the patient stay in hospital, how much calcium to be checked periodically, etc, etc, etc. But I'll just give you my protocol. In a case like what we've done yesterday, I'll put him on intravenous calcium support for 3 days anyway. And I'll put him on a oral support for 6 weeks anyway, regardless what I've done. And then withdraw and then start studying. For a very practical reason, that you cannot do a serial study of calcium on our patient. You cannot measure PTH, parathormone assays, they're expensive, and there's no point also. So if the patient is asymptomatic, follow this protocol. But if the patient does show symptoms or does show signs, then you have to add your treatment, the cholecalciferol or 1,2,5 deoxycholecalciferol, and thankfully all the calcium preparation in the market already has this built-in D3. And most of the calcium Sandoz or any standard company will incorporate, so do not worry about this 1,2,5 deoxycholecalciferol, it's there. But if it's not there, if you have a government job, then they get a pure calcium tablet, then you must remember that you have to add a sachet of calcirol, which is the 1,2,5 deoxycholecalciferol, twice in a week, that's enough. Because these tablets contain, every tablet contains deoxycholecalciferol. That is too much. You can just give them twice a week. Next please. Now, meet the tutors, Asha, suspect the unsuspected. You see, you must always, always feel that, see, this is a non-recurrent, recurrent on one side and loop on the other side. But again, as I said, these are my tutors, they keep on teaching me and they all teach me, please, please, there is an artery which goes there, respect it, see it and protect it. Next please. Now, this is a challenge, this is really, I had this specially made to show you that you can do what you like, but the God has got something else on his mind. This fellow has, this is the nerve, this is the central compartment clearance, this is common carotid arching there, that's the, you know, you've done everything correctly, but yet the patient had bilateral Robert Koch palsy at the end of surgery. No fault of ours, patient had that beforehand. You see, our patients are Panpara Gutka masters. He could not open his mouth, so we did not do the entire laryngoscopy. And then when this all happened, post-op, could not breathe, had to do a tracheostomy, all rush, scratching your head, sabko theek kiya tha. Even I had this, all these nerves should take care, sab over, nothing has been done wrong with this patient. Then why should my patient have a vocal cord palsy? Even yesterday, when we had to do a trache on that guy, I worried myself silly whether we are given a cord palsy. Because I believe that the post-operative stridor, if your patient gets, unless it's a case like Madan yesterday, is usually because of the abductor palsy and not because of hematoma. You can ask me why I say so later. But this is because we did not do IL and he had a trismus. And then I asked the relatives, Arey saab, iska awaaz to do baar chale gaya tha. You see, he had a vocal cord palsy in sequence because of malignancy. The first time it went, it came back because the other was compensating and it went off again. So this is a very rare thing, but one should keep in mind that this happens. Next please. Now this is the lady, this is the tutor in chief, Jini Bhai. We did this big surgery, we were very happy, but unfortunately I did not know this when I operated her. Now I know this, so I feel there will be no repetition of Jini Bhai again. But this is the only beautiful young girl, only 18 years old. You see, don't go by the parity of the patient in this part. They become, you know, they get married and they have children much earlier, even before you qualified to 12 standard. Jini Bhai was very young, 18 years old, and she died. She is my tutor in chief. She teaches me that respect this anatomy more than this nerve. Because this can kill. This will never kill. Next please. Now, this is something for you to see. I told you something, horses for courses. And this is a big, big case we had done on the cervical review. But then this was benign. I suspect that yesterday's case is malignant. And that is why we have so much trouble. It did shell out, you see. It was a benign God who was shelled out like this. And you can see she's been given a feed in the middle of the surgery. And we're still not closed. I deliberately put it like this for you to believe me that this was a pure cervical anesthesia. She's been fed or given a drop of water to drink. And this is a big cut. This is a big tumor. This is the neck. Next, please. Now, in conclusion, the sound knowledge of anatomy is almost unreplaceable, but complication can happen to every one of us. And as Rudyard Kipling's famous saying goes, unless it happens to you, you will not qualify to be a man. You will be a man, my son, only when things go wrong with you. If they never went wrong with you, you have not done enough. Thank you. What's happening there? I'll finish one. Hello? OT?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah, the patient has been taken up now.
Okay. Next on the case is who's who. So I better be there from the beginning. So this lecture will keep standing on RNA. World over. World over. Can I just run through and go through what you just give it? What? You see, this lecture is like Dasma Duttishtha Kaunteya Yuddhaya Abhivyasi. Have you heard this Sanskrit slok? The whole slok goes like that. Ato va prapasi svargam jitva va bhoksa sevani. That means, if you die here, you will go to heaven. Ato va prapasi svargam. If you die here, you are in heaven because God will take you up there with Him. But if you survive, heaven is here. Jitva va bhoksase ahim. If you win, the heaven is here. And therefore he says, Tasmat uttishta kaunteya. I mean, Arjuna uriva or lendego tayaraja. So this last lecture is with that background. And now you are fully equipped with all the knowledge that you need to have about the anatomy, the pathology, the surgical craftsmanship of thyroid. You just need to now get up and fight. Get up and go. Because if you win, you are a big surgeon. Even if you don't lose, you are not lost as a surgeon. You are still going to be up there. Don't worry. Next. Because see, when Arjun saw all his brothers, you know, all his cousins, all everybody there, he said, and he said, how can I kill them? Likewise, with all these nerves and vessels and arches and parataras, don't get disheartened. You can fight them. Next, please. You see, let's pay our respect to children of lesser God. Now, we have seen that the recurrent, the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is something which has been ignored by general surgeons in the past, and I don't worry too much, no, it doesn't matter. But don't do that. You see, you have to have a quality in your surgery, and to get quality in your surgery, you must produce results almost impeccable. And to do that, you must always, always try and get this particular nerve identified, that you can see the vein, the artery, and that you need the area of the thyroid. Next, please. Now, another lesser children of the God, children of a lesser God, is answer cervicalis. You see, whenever you will do next time, the neck dissection, please do this part little elaborately. Take the anterior branch, that's a loop, and from the anterior branch loop, you will get the branches coming. The point I want to see is that this is the attachment of the sternothyroid muscle, which is going up, so sternohyoid muscle, that's a hyoid, and that's a lateral border, that's going downwards, and you see where the nerve enters. It enters the muscle in the lower half. Full upper half, there is no nerve, but the nerve supply is here. So if you can cut anywhere between here and here, despite of the strap cutting, it will not cause any paralysis of the nerve, of the muscle. And after rejoining the muscle, you will get a normal functioning strap muscle. So the lesson learned from this particular slide is you are happy to cut anywhere above here, if you want to cut the strap muscle. And therefore, I told you yesterday, even if you cut the strap at the top, release you at the sternothyroid, it doesn't matter. Because the muscle will rejoin, and if you have a nerve supply, it will work. Next, please. Now, I told you this about all this slide, and Nidhi, I'll talk to you about this slide later because it's a very important slide. Ask me later. Next, please. Now, RLN is a complete nerve. You guys have got a motor component to it, which is obvious. All the muscles of the larynx except the parathyroid is supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. We learned that by heart 100 times as an undergraduate. Sensory, it is a sensory nerve for the infraglottic larynx below the vocal cords. It's very important because then the patients can have a diminished sensation there.
Hello.
Yeah.
Kapre sir?
Yeah, coming.
Hello.
Come on, Mike.
Hello.
Yeah, go.
तुझे
डॉक्टर गवारले किंवा देशपांडे आहे का ना कोणीच नाही इकडे म्हणून तुम्ही वाट
पाहता
ते आले की मी
निघतो
बरं तुमचं किती वेळ कारण यू अगेन वॉन्टेड बाय मॅडम यू एक 5 मिनिटं मोजून
ओके
ओके नाव लुक एट इट इट्स अ मोटर सेन्सरी सिक्रेटो मोटर सिक्रेटो मोटर अगेन द सेम पार्ट ऑफ द म्यूकोसा ऑफ द ट्रकिया अँड द सुप्राग्लॉटिक लॅरिंग्स and there are developmental variations in the right and the left, and there are nasal anatomical variations in the right and the left. And of course, lastly, the variations are there because of the pathology also. Because sometimes the tumor itself makes the nerve go well away from you. Next, please. Let's check one by one. The incidence of permanent palsies and medical legal status. Just one word. You see, the general surgical training in the past had been let the sleeping dog lie, and not disturb the recurrent nerve and don't bother demonstrating it. And to that effect, there was a big paper come with the incidence of recurrent nerve palsy in those patients where they did not see the recurrent nerve and in those patients where they saw the recurrent nerve. And they compared at 21% against 19%. So 19% was those where they didn't bother to see and 21% where they did demonstrate the nerve. And this paper came in about 2002. I can quote you the details of the paper if you are interested, but the point is not that, point is next. So at the prima facie report of this case, you feel, what's the hell? You know, if you don't see it, you say more. But now, take the paper further down and see what happens 6 months later. 6 months later, all those nerves which are paralyzed without seeing remain paralyzed. And 99.9% of those who became paralyzed because they were demonstrated came back to normal. That means this is neuropraxia because of your handling. And the more better you handle, the less neuropraxia you get. And therefore, there is no escape from not demonstrating the recurrent nerve. The second is the medical legal status. And this is a famous case from Ahmedabad. One of the surgeons did a surgery, had a recurrent palsy. The patient took him to the court for neglectful surgery or whatever. And the surgeon gave a quote, unquote, into the, I was brought up to believe, that's a typical British way of saying, I was brought up to believe that recurrent best not demonstrated and saved. And the opposition lawyer produced the Love and Bill's latest textbook, which says, the demonstration of recurrent nerve is mandatory in all thyroid surgery. And the surgeon lost the case and paid 4 lakhs of rupees, and this is about 10 years ago. So remember, even if you are unable to, you must make an effort to see the recurrent and document it like that, that you made your best possible effort to demonstrate and see the recurrent nerve. You cannot say, I did not see it because I didn't care. Next please. Now, normal anatomy, the right side, it loops around the subclavian rather than very laterally in the neck of the root of the neck and rises medially at a slant of 45 degrees in the TO2. Because it comes a little bit early, it takes a time to come in the groove and it slants at 45 degrees. So right now, like what we saw yesterday in that case, it's slanting a little bit more obliquely and doesn't come in the groove very quickly. And that's something which you should remember, that the right nerve is coming this way. Next one. The left one is coming along the ligamentous arteriosus, which is way back in the superior mediastinum. Therefore, it gets in the groove, it has a time to come in the groove, so usually it lies in the groove and then rises up. And it's very close to the esophagus. At that time, point of time, the esophagus starts moving to the left. So anatomy will remember, the right is away, the left is closed. And that pathology will come, this anatomical knowledge come handy, that in esophageal lesion, superior mediastinal lesion, is the left nerve which goes, not the right. So left palsy is on this account. Next please. Now variations of could be vessels, and the most important vessel is subclavian. Aberrant subclavian can give rise to aberrant recurrent nerve, and the most common example of aberrant vessel giving rise to aberrant recurrent is non-recurrent recurrent on the left, when the subclavian is actually retroesophageal. Ligament of Berry, I talked to you that Berry ligament can actually engulf the nerve and get push it back due to thyroid involvement and because of the assistant enthusiasm. You saw that the nerve was pulled practically on the anterior surface of the trachea and very, very easily damaged at that point with knuckles like this. If possible, I'll show you in the next case how to avoid that. Next please. Now, variations I just talked to you about. Next one. Change. Now this is statistics, it doesn't matter. Because your patient doesn't know the statistics. So you take it that this is going to be a difficult one. Next please. Now, you always think the recurrent, this is the knuckle I'm talking about. See, if Asin pulls the gland across, he makes a big knuckle and then you are in trouble. This nerve is because of the ligament of very, very thick and the nerve goes behind it. You have to be aware of that and that adjusts in front and behind it. The artery would be in front, the artery would be above, artery would be branching between like the case we did yesterday. Next please. Now this is again a similar example that the nerve is happily standing there, but artery is looping across and going there. You have to remember that this variation is very important for you to remember to protect it, that this is not the nerve. The nerve is there. Next please. Again, this is an unusual case, you know, I am just showing this changes. This is a different slide for this. Next. Now, usual variation that they run parallel like this. And we saw that yesterday. And you have to identify quickly and know which one is the nerve and which one is the artery. And there the loops come very handy. And the other variation is, you can see this dividing. Many times, the anterior branch is the real motor branch of the larynx and the posterior branch is the motor branch of the pharynx or the upper esophagus. And quite inadvertently, you keep the posterior branch and cut the anterior branch, thinking it's not enough. And you got a big disaster on hand. So always remember, even if you see it divided, you always remember which is going where and always respect the one in the front. Next, please. Now 1% they say, but if this is the first case you operate, it is 100% for you. It's a non-recurrent recurrent. Next, please. You can see, can I just go back on the slide? You can see this is the upper end and the nerve straight away comes out like this. Next. Now of course, you have to do which way the artery moves, which way the nerve moves. Forearm is forearm. Next. And this is what I mean to say when I'm saying about not removing the fascia. This is more like what I do now. I don't describe, I just see it there and move forward and don't dissect. Next, please. Ligament of Bailey, I just mentioned this. Next, please. And metallovision, this is a quickly RLM triangle, the lowest triangle, the base triangle, the man's inferior parathyroid, lower end stretching, and the TO2. I'll go through all this when I operate because there, I think there will be one more message over there. Next, please. I just close with saying this much and this much. Demonstration versus dissection. In the current context of the things, please do not dissect the recurrent nerve. Just demonstrate and be happy. And the second is lateral approach versus medial approach. What we I told you yesterday that if you let the inferior thyroid artery laterally and then come forwards with it, that was the lateral approach. And the lateral approach is good, very safe to begin with, but it kills the supply of the parathyroid. The medial lateral approach is little difficult, but once you get the hang of it, it is more better, it's better rather, to protect the parathyroid. Now, one more insight, one more advice. Why you should take the medial approach is that you are fresh at that time. If you have struggled with the case earlier on, by the time you come to the top end of the nerve, you are tired and you are likely to make a mistake. Because the nerve is never injured in the root of the neck, nerve is always injured, almost 99%, when it enters the larynx. So that's the time when you want to be fresh. And if you come in the medial lateral approach, you are very fresh. All you have done so far is middle thyroid vein and this upper core. And you are not really disturbed yourself with the rest of the dissection. So your mind is fresh. It's something like seeing the facial early on in mastoid surgery. If you leave it for too late and drill the whole cortex, you are about 2 hours in the surgery and tired. It's something like that. I think I'll push off. Can you just keep talking something? I'll leave it to Moni and we sorting out what is happening in the school.